Everybody, today I'm going to talk to you about my PhD project. I graduated last December from the University of Helsinki. So I will be talking to you about the role of BEC1 localization in autophagosome biogenesis. So what is autophagy? The term autophagy derives from the Greek eating of the self. And autophagy is a recycling and degradative pathway that is highly conserved in all eukaryotic cells. Autophagy is used to degrade cytoplasmic constituents that are larger than individual proteins by delivering them to the lysosome. Very importantly and interestingly, autophagy is the only pathway that is capable of degrading whole organelles. So why do we need autophagy? You have to consider that at a steady level, there is always some autophagy going on. So all of us at this moment probably has at least some autophagy that is happening in us, in our cells. And this autophagy is important for cellular homeostasy. Autophagy regulates cellular homeostasy by taking care of nutrient recycling, clearance of aggregate-prone proteins, organelle turnover, innate immune system, and cellular remodeling. As opposite to this, environmental changes can induce strongly autophagic response. Environmental changes can be starvation, organelle damage, ER stress, infection, and hypoxia. So as you can see, autophagy is regulating many, many processes, and there are many more that I didn't put in this slide. So considering how many processes autophagy is regulating, we shouldn't be surprised that impaired autophagy is actually involved in many nowadays important diseases, such as muscular diseases, infection diseases, cancer, cardiomyopathies, neurodegenerative diseases, and also aging. So, how does autophagy work? How our cells carry on autophagy? So, this is our cell. Upon induction, the first structure that is formed around the cargo is called isolation membrane or phagophore. The isolation membrane will continue to grow and expand until it will form a closed structure, which is called autophagosome. Importantly, the autophagosome is a double B-layer membrane vesicle, and it has no degradative capacity. So it's kind of our shopping bag with the stuff that the cells want to get rid of later on. So in the later stages of autophagy, the autophagosome will fuse with the lysosome, thus forming the final structure called a natto-lysosome. In this final structure, the real degradation happens via the lysosomal enzymes, and all the small building blocks that are reconstructed, they are released back to the cytoplasm for the cell to reuse. So this is again the same pathway that I showed you with some of the molecular regulators. Here I wanted to point out something that for us autophagy researcher is somehow very important. So one is the famous LC3. LC3 is considered the king marker of autophagy. So whenever in your system you might want to try to see if there is autophagy or you are interested in autophagy, LC3 is usually something that you should try, that you usually would try. LC3 is incorporated in both the membranes of the autophagosome, outer and inner, and its expression is significant, and it shows what's happening in the starvation, if there is an increase, and there is an induction, decrease, and so on. We use inhibitor of the later stages of autophagy. In my specific case, I've been using vafilomycin, which blocks lysosomal activity. And this also, as I will come to it a bit later, shows what's happened to autophagy, what about the induction, reduction, and so on. So what I've been studying in my PhD project was so I've been interested in the biogenesis. So I've been studying the BEC1 complex, BEC1 complex, and BEC1 itself. So a few words on the BEC1 protein. So BEC1, it's a 60 kilodalton protein that has different domains, as you can see from the figure, important from homologation, interaction with other proteins, lipid binding, translocation to the cytoplasm, and so on. BEC1 was actually first discovered as an interactor of the anti-apoptotic protein BCL2. Beclin-1, importantly, is encoded by a tumor suppressor that is monoallelically deleted in 40 to 75% of human breast, ovary, and prostate cancer. And Beclin-1 is actually a multifunctional protein and serves as a scaffold for different binding partners. So Beclin-1, importantly, not only regulates autophagy, but plays a role in many other processes, and it's a key checkpoint for all signals that will go further. And despite a lot is known, there are still many things that are still unclear regarding its role in autophagy. So why Beclin-1? Why Beclin-1 is important? The complex that Beclin-1 forms contains the small kinase VBS-15, ADG-14, and the very, very important kinase VBS-34. VBS-34 is a lipid kinase that will phosphorylate phosphatidyl inositol to form phosphatidyl inositol 3-phosphate. This lipid signaling is important and essential for downstream recruitment of all the other autophagy effectors. So if we don't have this, we are not going to have autophagy, or autophagy is severely impaired. So the importance of Beclin relies in its binding to this kinase. So now I will quickly tell you how the molecular mechanism work in the autophagosome biogenesis. So if we consider this as our south of autophagosome biogenesis, the first complex that comes in action is the ULK complex, which is formed by ULK with kinases and FIP200, ATG101, and ATG13. Then the ULK complex will recruit the Beclin complex. ULK will phosphorylate Beclin itself, ATG14 and VBS34, thus activating the Beclin complex. Then the Beclin complex will recruit phosphatidyl inositol, and VBS34 will phosphorylate phosphatidyl inositol, thus producing phosphatidyl inositol 3-phosphate and allowing correct formation on autophagosome and correct autophagy pathway. So a very big question. So autophagy is actually quite a young field, so there are many questions still to be answered. And one of the big questions in the field is the origin of the autophagosome membrane. So you have to consider that now when autophagy is happening, there is a new kind of structure that is forming, which is the autophagosome. So who is actually giving lipids to this new structure? Where are the lipids coming from that help the structure to grow? So when I started my project many, many, many years ago, it was all kind of about mitochondria, ER, endoplasmic reticulum, and the plasma membrane. But as research has progressed and, you know, technologies has been advancing and so on, we now talk also about mitochondria ER contact site, mitochondria-associated membranes, the endosomal pathway, the Golgi, the ER exit sites, and so on. Though there are so many subcellular compartments involved in the autophagosome biogenesis, the endoplasmic reticulum is still believed to be somehow the king organelle that helps the growth of the isolation membrane. You can find and not find all of the others, but the ER will always be there, helping somehow the isolation membrane and autophagosome to grow. A few years into my PhD, this group published this data, say this article. So here you can recognize again the pathway that I've been telling you. So we have the ULK complex, the Beclin complex, and autophagy induction. And this article showed that in absence of the ULK kinases, autophagy induction is severely impaired. So keeping this in mind, we kind of came to our aim, and we wanted to answer if Beclin-1 targeted to the endoplasmic reticulum was able to rescue the ULK1, ULK2 knockout phenotype. So if we don't have ULK, which is important to activate the Beclin complex, can we still have autophagy happening? Is Beclin alone able to induce autophagosome formation without the ULK step? So how did we do that? I constructed Beclin-1 targeting constructs. So we have usually a tag with Beclin-1, and then we have mitochondria targeting sequence that targets the protein to the mitochondria. And in this case, we have Beclin-1 followed by an ER targeting sequence. And we also, of course, had Beclin-1 with no targeting sequence called the wild type Beclin. And to be sure that the results we were seeing, that the effects we were seeing were due to Beclin itself, we have controlled construct where we have the same tag, the same targeting sequence, but no Beclin-1 insert. So the first thing we did was to, of course, make sure that our constructs were going in the exact compartment, in the correct compartment. So here we have used HEC293 cells. So here we have a stable cell line with HA tagged backlink 1 here to the ER and here to the mitochondria. And we performed double immunofluorescence against HA and BAP31, which is an ER marker. So as you can see from the merge picture, there is a very nice colocalization. So the ER construct is going, backlink ER is going to the correct subcellular compartment. And here again, we have immunofluorescence against HA and TOM20, which is a mitochondrial marker. Here the colocalization is not like a full colocalization, but there are good parts of the backlink mitochondria that are going to the mitochondria. And we, of course, wanted also to see how the cytoplasmic, the non-targeted backlink one would look, and that showed a predominant cytoplasmic localization. We use this same cell line to see what happens to the wild-type backlink upon starvation. So we starve our cells with the EBSS, which is a medium without amino acid and serum. And we could see that upon starvation, backlink 1 was enriched into the ER, which would somehow confirm again the primary role of the ER. So then we collaborated with the proteomic units of our university, and we did mass spec to look for the known interactors of backlink 1 in all of our constructs. So this is a very big chart, so I will just focus here, which are our autophagy hits. And we have, of course, always full media and starvation. And in all of the constructs and all of the conditions, we were able to find what we were looking for, which were our known interactors. So for example, here we look like the kinases are here, the two kinases, then ATG14 and some other that I haven't mentioned to you. And there were really big differences between the construct or the condition. So the abundance of the complex was similar in all of them. So now to the part of the MEFULC knockout, so to the rescue part. So this is a very big graph. I try to walk you through this and kind of give you the big message. So we received the cell lines, the MEF wild type here, and the MEF ULK1, ULK2 knockout cell line from our collaborators. So what I did here, I transfected these cells, transfected with my GFP tag constructs, and I starved them. I kept them either in full media, starved them, or starved them with bifilomycin. So, and then I quantified LC3. As I told you, LC3 is like the most important marker, and for us, it tells us about autophagy and what's happening. So I will focus on this part, which was the most important result of this graph. So these are knockout cell lines expressing the ER targeted backlink 1. And we can see that upon starvation, there was a very nice increase in LC3 signal compared to full media and compared to non-expressing cells and targeting control expressing cells. So this would tell us that backlink 1 targeted DR was able actually to induce a very good response in absence of the ULK kinases. But when we add bifilomycin, we could see that there wasn't a really a big increase between starvation to starvation plus bifilomycin. So usually when you have bifilomycin, you should see this bar very much higher because you are blocking this, the later stages, so the autophagosome are actually accumulating. So in my case, this was not happening. So this meant that there was something wrong with this formation, and this was due to the fact that actually in starvation, this increase was not due to a lot, an increase of formation, but a decreased fusion, because there was something wrong happening with the later stages. So the kind of take-home message from this graph was that, okay, backlink 1 target to the ER can help forming autophagosome in absence of the ULK kinase, but these autophagosomes are not fusing well, are not maturing well. The same cell line, the ULK knockout and the MEF wild type and MEF wild type ULK knockout cell line was used to also check here how the backlink 1 localization was happening, was changing upon starvation. And interestingly, what we saw, so in both MEF wild type and MEF ULK knockout, upon starvation, backlink localization to the ER was enriched. But what was interesting was that compared to MEF wild type, in MEF UL knockout, there was way much Beclin 1 in the ER, assuming somehow that ULK1 and ULK2 kinases are regulating Beclin 1 localization in the ER in nutrient-rich condition. Once we saw that ULK knockout cell lines can make autophagic structure, can induce autophagy, we wanted to see how these structures were looking like. So we did correlative light electron microscopy, where you go and check your fluorescent cell of interest under electron microscope. And so we wanted to see what kind of structure we could find. So here we have a cell expressing Beclin wild type. And then in under electron microscopy, we could see that there were both degradative, like later degradative autophagic structure and initial immature autophagic structure. And also here with the Beclin mito, we could find nicely same type of structure. And this is a cell expressing the Beclin ER, and we could find something here and here and here. So all this structure that these cells were able to form were looking normal, and the size was also normal. So I will try now to summarize the data that I've been telling you. So under nutrient-rich condition, we were able to show that the ULK kinases help Beclin 1 sustain Beclin 1 localization at the ER. Under starvation, when autophagy is induced, Beclin 1 was found to be enriched in the ER. More importantly, in our results, we were able to show that in absence of the ULK1, ULK2 kinases, forced targeting of Beclin 1 to the ER was able to recruit Beclin 1 binding partners, such as the kinases VPS15, VPS34, and ATG14, and was able to start to induce autophagosome formation. The autophagosome forms in this condition, in absence of the kinases, were normal-looking autophagic structure, but they were not able to mature and fuse with lysosome, thus suggesting that the ULK1 and ULK2 kinases are required for autophagosome maturation. To conclude, Beclin 1 construct targeted the ER and mitochondria localized to their expected compartment. Beclin 1 construct bind to the known Beclin 1 interactors, both in full medium and EBSS. Beclin 1 is enriched in the ER upon starvation, and Beclin 1 targeted the ER was able to partially rescue autophagosome formation in ULK1, ULK2 knockout cells, but autophagosome maturation was impaired in these cells. I will conclude just with the acknowledgement of course, my former lab and my former boss, Evalisa Eskelinen, and President for my lab members, the funding and the collaborators. And thank you all for your attention.